Mr. Jack Dangermon, founder and president, Esri Incorporated. Other dignitaries present here, delegates, GIS professionals, IT professionals, policy makers, users, students, and ladies and gentlemen. Very good morning to you all. Esri User Conference has always been a wonderful forum for GIS professionals to learn, explore, and update their knowledge in various technology verticals and latest technological development in geospatial domain. I have attended few of them, and certainly I say that I got benefited immensely out of that. And today's theme is the GIS enabling transformation. I think today it is more up to my organization, Surveyor of India, and I'll tell you how it is. As you are all aware, Surveyor of India has completed 250 years this year, and we have been in the service of the country for 250 years, and I would like to inform you as Surveyor General of India that we are celebrating this achievement by conducting several technical programs starting next week with the World Geospatial Forum at Hyderabad. We are starting off our programs, and there will be a lot many programs and initiatives that will be announced this year. These activities, the next week which we are starting, will kickstart during the Geospatial World Forum at Hyderabad. Survey of India, ladies and gentlemen, you may be aware that it started in the year 1767 by the East India Company, and then it was taken over by the British government, and then finally after the independence we are with Government of India. First it was raised as Survey of Bengal, then later Survey of Bombay was raised, then Survey of Madras was raised, and all the three were amalgamated and made into one unit, that is Survey of India, in the year 1815. Survey of India from its inception till today has undergone several changes to adapt itself to the need of the day to help the country. Its journey started with mapping for the military needs. Absolutely, it was started by the East India Company to suit its military needs. In fact, the documentation says that Survey of India was founded to help the company in expanding its territories. So that is how the organization was started way back in 1767. Its journey started with mapping for the military needs, and then after independence, it was given the mandate of providing survey and mapping services for the development of to help the developmental activities in the country under Government of India, along with serving the mapping needs for both security agencies as well. This change in mandate was necessitated by country's needs and policies. Survey of India, to fulfill its role, had to embrace new technologies and new methods. Fortunately, we have been doing that continuously. Earlier, Survey of India was provided necessary geodetic control framework for the country, meet mapping needs of planning exercises, and carry out specific surveys for engineering projects. So this was a sort of a limited mandate we had. And then the work culture, fortunately, in Survey of India is very well developed and very good. The procedures and the standard operating procedures for various survey operations that we have are very well documented, and using that, we never had a problem in working in the analog way, we can say, because today we are in the digital age. Okay. The work culture was a complicated triangulation. The methods were so beautiful, ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you, a very complicated triangulation calculation was also done by a matriculate. Because during those days, of course these days we are not doing triangulation, with the GPS available it is not required. But I remember, I joined in 83, even during those days also, for any kind of triangulation, if I assign it to one of my chaps, who barely is a matriculate, all that he does is he'll go to the record keeper and he'll say, I am assigned this job. And the record keeper used to give him a bunch of forms. The forms were so beautiful, I'll tell you, if you observe a triangle, the sum of the angles should be 180 degrees. So the form is so designed, it says column station A, B, C, angle observed, sum of the angle, And underneath, there is a line saying that if it is plus or minus more than 10 seconds, you have to repeat. So this man, he can't go anywhere. He used to do it like that. Similarly, for every exercise that we have done, that kind of documentation was done. We call it, SOPs were there. And we could do that job very well. If I give a 200 kilometer of leveling line, a double territory or single territory line to any of my chaps, again, most of Survey of India field staff were barely matriculates. They were trained by us, but even they could do a 200 kilometer line was nothing. There was no problem at all. I have come across many state government agencies with their own surveyors. Even 500 meters was a problem for them. Okay, this kind of culture is what we could develop. After we, around 60s, we have adopted the photogrammetric methods. Once again, the documentation was perfect and the training was also perfect. With the same type of manpower that we have, we shifted over to the analog photogrammetric methods, and we have done a tremendous job in that. The entire country, today, the 50,000 maps which we have published, the base for that is done through the analog photogrammetry. The photogrammetric units were very well sort of organized, and no officer was posted there unless he was trained in advanced photogrammetry. Even I got trained, after that only I was posted to a photogrammetric unit. See, this kind of culture we had, and because of that we could smoothly transit into the photogrammetric era. Most of the work was field intensive, but we could do this hard work due to the excellent commitment and dedication of employees of Survey of India. Like earlier, the methods were absolutely field methods. We started with what we call a blank PT section. A white sheet was taken initially to the field. The mapping was done. It was brought inside. Then we graduated to photogrammetric methods using air photography, using analog machines, huge machines we used to have. The map was made in the office, that is lab itself, and it was printed in blue and then sent to the field for verification. So the job was slightly easier. They could do it. But it was also field intensive only. And believe me, during those days, the mapping cycle was 15 years. Mapping cycle, what I mean is, if I map one area today, this area, once again I come to revise the map only after 15 years. That used to be the mapping cycle. But still with this also, we could meet the mapping demands of the country to a greater extent satisfactorily, because so much pressure was not there during those days. And sufficient planning was also there. Say if somebody is, like, we have done a lot of project works. We have done that HVJ pipeline survey was done by us. And then many of them were done. But enough planning was there. We used to send, we had a lot of manpower. Survey of India was 30,000 strong during those days. Today we are between 5,000 to 6,000. Okay. But because of these kind of reasons, we could meet the demands of the country. And during the emergencies, like war situation and all, we operated our printing presses in the three shifts to meet the demand of the defense forces. So we could meet the demands of the country. In another word, is that because of the large manpower and putting in more efforts, we could do that. Now, as you are all aware, the times have changed. We have entered the digital age or the computer age. Like everybody, we are also sort of compelled to get into the digital age, which was a need of the hour. And we started working in the digital environment way back. And then by 2005, we have completed digitization of all our maps. All the maps that were there with us on 1:50,000 and other scales also, we have completely digitized them. And now the field work which we are doing now, in future, whatever the work that we are going to do, that is going to be in completely the digital form. That is what the way we are planning. Yeah, when we have entered the digital, GIS technology, as you know, has come into the country, and in my opinion, it made a big difference. It made the people, the government, the organizations aware of the importance of the maps, and now we call them geospatial data. But the importance of the map was realized, in my opinion, only after the GIS came into existence. Okay, so much so that this created so much of awareness and so much of excitement. I would say I met some people who do not know what digitization is. there were people who came to me and they said, can you digitalization, can you do this for us? These kind of people, everybody wanted to jump in. Of course, this was around 90s. Now, gradually things have sort of taken a proper shape, I would say. Now, I think if you see the government of India, many of the organizations are implementing their programs in GIS. So this is a marked change that has happened. The transition took place probably, in my opinion, from say around 2007-8 or so. In the last 10 years only this thing has happened. And obviously the fall, I don't call it a fall, we came under pressure because of this. Earlier, there were occasions, I spent a lot of time in the field, running field offices. There were occasions when people used to ask for the map. If I give them 5 years old map, they were happy. Okay, today, if I say I have a 5 year old map, the client is not happy. He wants the map of yesterday or probably tomorrow also. This is the way they are speaking. This is the change that has come into the country. I'm really happy to say, even though we are under pressure, still it gives sort of immense satisfaction to see that what we are doing is directly useful to the country and people have started recognizing it. GIS technology has brought a paradigm shift in the demand for mapping services, both in terms of time and specification. Earlier, for any project work, we used to sit across a table with the client, have a detailed discussion, fix the specification, and then take up slowly in the sense in our own methods, and which used to take a longer time. Today, as I said, if I propose, if somebody comes to me, an organization, and they say they want to, you say, put a railway line of 100 kilometers or 200 kilometers, and if I say I'm going to give them a map next year, I don't think they'll ever come back to my office. Because today the change so much has come that I have to speak in terms of weeks. And fortunately, we are more or less prepared for that as well. Unlike earlier, today the client do not want a map even in digital form of a rectangular area. What I mean by rectangular area is, if you have seen Survey of India map, we have divided the country by latitude and longitude, and each map sheet contains a area contained in a rectangle. Today, the demand is that nobody is interested in the rectangular form or anything. They say, I want only this specific area of the map. That is the area of interest, like in the computer terms, what you call the area of interest. These kind of developments are taking place. The client wants it in real time. It further changed with the awareness of effectiveness of GIS technology. He wants it GIS compatible or GIS ready. More demanding clients ask for not the geospatial data today, they are asking for geospatial solutions. Okay. This has compelled Survey of India also to change from supply of maps to map data to a comprehensive mapping solution provider. So this is the transformation that we are expected to undergo in a very, very short time. Okay. This needs reinvention of Survey of India. Like, I have still the average age of my employees today is around 55 or so. Okay, most of them, they started their career using the hard copy maps. They are very comfortable if I give them a plane table, but when I give them a desktop, they are not that comfortable. Still, of course, we train them, we sort of got them interested in making various kinds of offers, and now I have a good manpower who are quite comfortable in the digital environment also. But this is, as I said, this requires that today's situation, as I described earlier, requires a complete transformation of Survey of India from a supplier of hard copy map to a supplier of geospatial solution. And how does it happen? This can happen by adopting the right technologies and practices leading to proper capacity building. With the right kind of trained manpower and technological system available, the organization can effectively meet the challenges that come its way. So, geospatial domain is evolving tremendously in our country and offering ample opportunities to GIS and IT professionals for growth and development. Geospatial industry in India is witnessing the transformation with government focus on the use of geospatial technology in all flagship mega projects like smart cities, NH projects, housing projects, Clean Ganga, these are all the projects. Like, unlike earlier, say 10, 15 years ago, or 10 years ago also, the government was not so focused on the GIS technology. As I said, today every government department is sort of, they want to do this, execute all these projects using the GIS technology, which is a very healthy development. And I think it is a great opportunity for the GIS professionals as well. The new development with the extensive use of GIS tools and technologies in the decision making, planning and implementation by Government of India with initiatives in e-governance and G-governance will definitely establish the advantages offered by the GIS, like usefulness, cost effectiveness and economic benefits. Since the magnitude of works and data produced by Survey of India are generally very large, it requires production automation. Like earlier, on 1:50,000 scale, we had about 4,800 maps that were covering the country. Now I proposed the scale of 1:10,000 to Government of India under NGIS. That requires 120,000 maps. Now the demand is, I am not allowed even 1:10,000. The order is that now I should produce the maps on 1:4,000 scale directly, which is 1.2 into another 2.5 times. So you can imagine, see, to control production of 4,800 maps was manually possible with, say, I have 25 field officers, directors are there, there was a mechanism. But today, with, if I have to produce 4 lakhs or 5 lakhs of map sheets, each sheet has to be sort of, we can't afford to go wrong in any of the sheets. Like Survey of India map sheet, for your information, is sort of an authoritative document in this country. If I map something, that can be produced in the court of law. So I have the responsibility to produce a map with 100% accuracy and correctness. So this involves, absolutely, the map has to be 100% correct and it is to be properly supervised. And that is why, if I go by my old methods, like earlier we used to have the progress reports moving from office to office in the hard copy format in a paper, and then again corrections are made, instructions are passed on. If I do this, I think I'll not be able to complete this job in the next 10 years to come. Whereas the government expects it in the next 2 years to happen. So here is where I think the IT should come and help us. That is a process should, that to do this, a process should be evolved to monitor the activities from data collection in the field to data dissemination to the client. Completely, we require an automation in this direction. My man is going to a remote village in the country, he completes the job, I have to tell him the instant he completes whether he has done the job properly or not, because I can't afford to send him back after a few months saying that you make a correction there. I have to tell him on the day one itself that you finish the job here, shift to the next place. These are the kind of things I have to come out with. Like even the data also, that day it is completed across the country, it has to get into the archival and should be ready for supply to the client. So this requires a huge amount of automation. What is needed is a software that can accommodate a workflow of activities from capture of data to production of seamless end product. This is the most essential thing that we are looking at. Further on the management or administration side, serious and effective automation is to be done to exercise control at various levels of supervision, generation of reviews, approvals, etc. This kind of dashboard software will be essential to monitor various kinds of activities from field point to the data storage locations. Capacity building is going to be one of the key challenges in the geospatial domain in the present scenario, as these mega projects require huge data capturing and data processing capabilities across various technological areas covering digital photogrammetry, LiDAR, drones, remote sensing techniques, etc. Like, as I just mentioned, I have only a 5,000 strong manpower, and we are getting so many projects which we have to, most of the work is going to be outsourced. So I think this is where the capacity building, not only on my side, probably outside also, like I mean in the industry side also, we'll be requiring this kind of thing to meet the need of these projects. Presently, geospatial domain is getting embedded into IT and engineering workflows, which requires more and more cross-discipline experts to effectively leverage the maximum advantage within short span of targeted timelines for such projects. In such a scenario, conferences like this, USAID conference, offers wonderful opportunities for the professionals. Ladies and gentlemen, you are aware that geospatial policy domain is also witnessing discussions and deliberations at various levels of Government of India in view of these cutting-edge technological developments. I am quite positive and hopeful for the emergence of certain visionary initiatives in the policy domain in future by policymakers. There was a sort of, concern from the industry about the geospatial policy. The draft policy that has come was very stringent. But let me inform you, the geospatial policy that is likely to come up is going to be very user-friendly and very industry-friendly as well. Because the realization has come that we have to, in the geospatial domain also, a lot of relaxation is required. That message has gone to the decision makers, I would say. Some of the projects that Survey of India is undertaking are the national projects like we have completed the DSSDI, and then presently we are continuing with the ICZM project, Integrated Coastal Zone Management Project, and then CMPDA project, and we just started the National Hydrology Project 3, where we are mapping the rivers of the country. For various central ministries as the premier national mapping agency of the country. And we are preparing the GIS data sets for these agencies. Unlike earlier, we are not producing the typical Survey of India topographic map, but we have a lot of interaction with the clients, and these maps are almost tailor-made for them. Okay. We have been working towards the effective use of the enterprise workflow management solutions integrated with management information system tools for maximizing the production outputs of our processing centers. And all these projects, we expect a lot. Like I am promising something tailor-made to the client, but at the same time, as you know, Survey of India, we are not so IT, experts, or we are not that IT intensive. We understand the software. We have people who are very good in operating it, who are very good in producing the work using the software. But at the same time, we are not very strong in software customization or software production. I think this is where I think we'll be looking at the industry in the next few months to come. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I am quite confident that all the delegates and professionals will make best use of this, of all sessions, technology exposition, lectures, and discussions of this user conference to improvise their implementation strategies, solutions, and understanding of the Esri products. And with this, I thank you all. Thank you very much.